Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship on this, the third Sunday of Easter. It's great to be gathered in the love of Jesus. Special welcome to those of you who are joining us online this morning. We are so grateful you're with us as we gather to worship our Savior, Jesus Christ. At this time, too, for those of you online, if you'd like to find some wine and bread or juice or something with which you can partake of Holy Communion along with us a little bit later in worship, I ask that you do that at this time. That would be absolutely wonderful. Special celebration today in that we are celebrating the 40th anniversary of the English Ringers. And I'll be we'll be talking about that a little bit later in worship. But a wonderful day of celebration. Special word of welcome to everyone who's visitors with us this morning. We are so grateful that you're with us. Before we start worship, I have a great ministry minute from our youth gathering team for an update. So take it away.
My name is Elena Trushensky.
I'm Landon Trushensky. And today we'll be talking about the ELCA National Youth Gathering. And this is a gigantic event that happens every 3 years in different cities across the country. The gathering usually lasts around 5 days, with each day having its own theme. But because of COVID-19 pandemic, the last National Youth Gathering was in Houston, Texas in 2018, 6 years ago. This year's English Lutheran Church has 8 kids and 3 adult leaders that will be traveling to New Orleans, Louisiana. And once there, we'll be joined by over 15,000 other youth that will be challenged to be brave, be authentic, be free, be disruptive, and be disciples. And we have also been blessed to work alongside and will be traveling with youth from First Lutheran on Alaska and Mindoro, Lewis Valley. Once a month, we come together and explore the daily themes, introduced the host city and the gathering. Together, we engage in scripture and we have space to discuss and reflect on everything.
Our planning started in January and fundraising began in February with a goal of $8,000. Thanks to many generous members at ELCA, we are over halfway to our goal at $5,687 to be exact. While eating pancakes, enjoying Parents' Night Out, purchasing script cards, and praying for us through contributing through the wall of envelopes, our church family has demonstrated how much support we have. We continue to ask your support in whatever way possible. In 3 short months, we will embark on an adventure that will take us across the country to experience, explore, and discover new things about ourselves and learn about what God has planned for us. Very soon, there will be a display in the narthex sharing a little bit more about each of us attending the youth gathering. Please take the time to learn why this trip is so important to each of us, what we are most excited about and are anxious about, the different ways that you can be praying for us as we prepare for the trip and while we are in New Orleans. Thanks again for your time and support.
Thank you so much. It's going to be a transformative adventure for you and for all of us. Because from their experience, we also as a congregation will be changed for the better. And so thank you so much. Our worship continues with the thanksgiving for baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy. Amen. Amen. Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Alleluia.
Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Alleluia. At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Alleluia.
We stand in body and spirit as we join in our opening hymn, Come Join the Dance of Trinity. And this piece was commissioned in honor of the 40th anniversary of the English Ringers. And Jim, do we have instructions?
Yes.
Okay.
So the instructions, let's see here, it was arranged by Paul McLevin. And the first tune, it's got two different tunes together. The first tune, Forest Green, you're just going to be listening. And then about 50 measures into it, I'll give you a big cue. And then you start singing Kingsfold, which is during the Dance of Trinity, I think is what comes up there. So, and once you start singing, you just sing all four verses right now. And that takes us to the end of the class. So, hope you enjoy. Saints, come join the Dance of Trinity.
Thank you.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Well, as we have said, we are celebrating the 40th anniversary of the English Ringers, and I'd just like to take an opportunity to kind of tell you the story, or the chronology, the timeline of this great group, including some of our members who have been so involved in its starting. Way back in 1983, at a meeting of the Worship Council, it was decided that a handbell choir would be a really good thing to do. And that began a whole long process. A lot of work goes into forming an ensemble of this caliber. There's a lot of moving parts, a lot of expenses. It is not cheap to have a bell choir. The bells are expensive, and all the paraphernalia that goes along with it, the tables, the coverings, music, and everything is really involved. And so back in 1983, a lot of people came together to raise money to get this started. It's important for us to acknowledge the donations from Mary Meyer for her mother, the Tomalka family, in honor of Jean Tomalka Smaby, and who paid for the first bells. A lot of people, but it was their instigation, their initial gifting that allowed this. It started out as a three-octave choir. Is that right, Nancy? It was a three-octave choir. We are up to five octaves, right? And so that is, that goes a long ways. It's been such a huge part of our congregation, the life of our congregation. And I would just like to, at this time, acknowledge we've had four directors of the English Ringers. Our first director was Nancy Matchett. She was our director from 1984 to 1994. Nancy was followed by Chris Knutson, who was the director from 1994 to 1996. Marla Engblom from 1996 to 2013. And now Jim Knutson, who you've been here for 10 years. Yeah, started in 2014 until this present time. And so at this time, first of all, I would like to acknowledge we have all of our directors are with us, although we're hoping that Chris is joining us online. Chris, we hope you're with us online or that you get a chance to see this. I don't see you. Nope. we put out the invitation for Chris to join us online, so we hope that you're with us this morning, Chris, as well. But at this time, I invite us to acknowledge and give thanks for Nancy Matchett. Nancy's in our back row right now. And Marla Ingram, I saw there she is, Marla. And Chris Knutson, we mentioned, and Jim Knutson. And at this time, too, I'd just like to ask anybody who has participated in the English Ringers to please stand at this time. There we go. Hey. And Sarah has something to share as well.
We thought today would be a fitting opportunity to thank Jim for his dedication to our group as well. Thank you for, we think 11, if I did the math, 11 wonderful seasons as the English Ringers director. We hope you take the next few months to do all the things you love, spending time with your kids and grandkids, biking, boating, making music, and relaxing. We appreciate you. And some other words from our members. We just have a group gift. Stop it. Well, you put so much joy and energy into this group. Thank you. I so enjoy playing under your direction and enjoy your easy personality and positive attitude. And something you say for us, and we love it too, is playing together is praying together.
Thank you, Sarah. Let us pray. Gracious God, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for the gift of music. We thank you for the gift of gathering together. And boy, I tell you, what it means to be the body of Christ is so beautifully illustrated in the joy of ringing. Because it takes a whole team of ringers to make music. And everybody needing and relying on each other to keep that melody line going. We thank you, Lord, for the witness, the powerful witness of the English ringers throughout the years, and all their directors, for Nancy and Marla and Chris and Jim and all the people that have been involved in this ensemble, and the gift that they've been to us and are to us as we worship you, Lord. We thank you. We ask that you bless this group. We ask that you continue to bless us with the gift of this wonderful music. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much, Bess.
Thank you.
This time I invite our young people to come up and join me. Any of our young folks want to come on up? Come on up, everyone. Good to see you guys. Good to see you. Good morning. Good morning. It's great to see you. So maybe some of you have noticed that, like, when we gather for worship, there are words that show up a lot in how we worship and how we do things together on Sunday mornings or Saturday nights whenever we gather for worship. And one of the things, have you ever noticed kind of at the end of worship that I will say something along the lines like this? It's a blessing, right? We usually end our worship with a blessing. And it might be words like this: the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's make your face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. And does that sound familiar? Maybe there's a lot of words about blessing. So when I say that, what do you suppose I'm saying and wishing for you? The Lord bless you. When I say that, Michael, any ideas? Like if I say to you, God bless you, or the Lord bless you. Any idea? No? Well, what other times do we say bless you? Here's an example. Bless you, right? Sometimes we say it when people sneeze, but actually, it's significant when we say that. It's not just like, oh, we're just being nice, you know, to say something when somebody sneezes. Although it's kind of weird that we say it when people sneeze. But the thing is, when we say the Lord bless you, we're hoping for all kinds of good things for you. When Pastor Becky and I say the Lord bless you, we hope so much for you. And it kind of came to me a lot this last Thursday. Ann and I, we got to go to a concert, and at this concert, one of the singers that was involved in the concert actually said at the end of the concert, bless you! That was really good timing, by the way. At this concert, the lead singer of the group said to the whole audience, God bless you. And you know what? I didn't expect that. You know, in a concert, you know, wasn't in church or anything like that, but somebody took the time to say, God bless you. And that's really got me thinking, what a gift it was to hear that. Because when we ask that the Lord bless you or God bless you, what we're hoping for is for everything good for you, everything good that the Lord can bring, everything that God can bring. You know, and what are some good things that God brings us? Anybody? What are some good things that God brings us? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. Yeah. Love. Yeah. Well, ditto, right? Love times two. But that's what we're hoping for. Everything good can possibly happen. That there can be peace and there can be love and there can be that you're taken care of, that you know that God loves you so much. And that is a really great gift. And so I think as you guys are going back to your seats today, maybe take a second, like, to those people that you're going to walk past to go back to your seats. And they might not even be people that you know, but take the risk and tell them, God bless you. Can you try that on your way back to your seats? But before we do that, let's pray. And this is a repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for blessing us.
Thank you for blessing us.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, you guys can go back to your seats. Thank you.
Today's psalm is Psalm 4, and we will read it responsively. Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I was in distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer.
You mortals, how long will you dishonor my glory? How long will you love illusions and seek after lies?
Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. The Lord will hear me when I call.
Tremble then, and do not sin. Speak to your heart in silence upon your head.
Offer the appointed sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord.
Many are saying, who will show us any good? Let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord.
You have put gladness in my heart more than when grain and wine abound.
In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, Lord, may make rest secure.
Word of God, word of life. The second reading for today is from 1 John chapter 3. God has loved us in order to make us children of God. Though we do not yet know the full details of our future existence, we trust that God will reveal it, just as God revealed Jesus to take away our sins. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him, for we will see Him as He is. And all who have this hope in Him purify themselves just as He is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that He was revealed to take away sins, and in Him there is no sin. No one who abides in Him sins. No one who sins has either seen Him or known Him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
According to Luke, the 24th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. Jesus said to them, "Why are you frightened and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. So, how many of you have ever watched the television game show, The Price is Right? Let me see a show of hands. How many of you have ever been asked in a sermon if you've ever watched The Price is Right? Okay, Luke and Ann raised their hands. They were at worship last night. So besides them, yeah, okay, not too many. Well, this show has been on TV forever, right? It's a great game show with a lot of fun and excitement. And my favorite part of the show is right at the beginning. A number of contestants are asked to try, well, you know, first of all, they're asked to come on down. And then after that, they're asked to try to guess the price of an item. And if they are closest to the actual price of the object without going over, they get a chance to come up on stage, to be in the presence of that venerable game show host, Drew Carey, and of course, before him, Bob Barker, and then have the opportunity to win more prizes as they play more games. And my gosh, the emotions that those who are chosen show. They scream, they cry, they jump up and down. They try to grab good old Drew and hug him and kiss him. Yes, even the guys. It is as if they just can't believe that they are actually on nationwide TV. It's almost as if the news that they're going to be up on stage with Drew and get a chance to play more games, it's almost too good to be true. And the emotions overwhelm them. And it's everything that Drew can do to get the contestants to calm down so that the show can continue. But Drew is always up to the task. He seems to have a way of bringing calm and order back into a scene of chaos. In the gospel story for today, from the last chapter of Luke, we are given a scene of emotions run amok. A scene in which those who have followed Jesus experience something that's almost too good to be true. The disciples are gathered together in a house. The women have reported to them that the tomb was empty. Simon and Peter has experienced the risen Lord Jesus. And Cleopas and another disciple have encountered the risen Christ on their way home from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And Jesus is revealed as they broke bread with Jesus in their very own home. And now, after running all the way back to Jerusalem and telling everyone what they've seen, Jesus comes among them, all of them, and says, "Peace be with you." What they experience is too good to be true. And we read that the disciples were terrified, and they thought that Jesus was a ghost. As this visit continues, we read that they're filled with joy, but in that joy, they couldn't bring themselves to actually believe what they were experiencing. Now, of course, Bob Barker or Drew Carey are not Jesus, but the situation of having to bring calm to a group of people overcome with emotion is something that both they and Jesus are very good at. Just imagine Jesus coming into the room and saying, "Peace be with you." And then, if you're Jesus, having this profoundly beautiful greeting met with terror and fear. I can imagine Jesus thinking, "Oh boy, now what? Look, see, here are my hands, here's my feet. See the nail marks? It's me. I am really here with you." They still can't believe it. So Jesus then tries another approach. Touch me. See, I'm not a ghost. Ghosts don't have flesh and bones like I do. Well, that doesn't work either. So Jesus tries one more approach. Jesus asks them, "Do you have anything to eat?" They give him a piece of broiled fish. Now, for those of you who are Norwegian, I'm sure it wasn't lutefisk, but I'm sure it was pretty good. And Jesus eats it. I can imagine Jesus talking between bites. This is great fish. See, I'm eating. I'm taking bites and chewing and swallowing. I am really here with you in the flesh. Peace be with you. What a good and gracious Savior Jesus is to come to his disciples in a way that they can grasp in eating. I mean, all people need to eat. It is something that everybody understands. And Jesus comes not in some form that is incomprehensible. Even in his risen state, after suffering death and then rising, Jesus comes to his disciples as flesh and blood, bone, eating fish. And to this day, my friends, Jesus comes to us in a very real, a very physical, touchable way. So we've talked about this, and you notice this, that Jesus asks for something to eat. And it is in this act of giving broiled fish to Jesus that they come to know that it is really Jesus who is with them. When I think about that, I'm reminded of another story, in fact, a parable of Jesus that we hear from the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus is talking about the end of the ages when the sheep and the goats will be separated. Maybe some of you remember that story. And the Lord, who is separating out those who will enter the kingdom and those who will not, says to those who are entering, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." Right? "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink." Jesus says to those listening that they will experience him in the act of feeding him, of giving him something to drink. Jesus calms the chaos in the room, saying, "Peace be with you." And saying, "Do you have anything to eat?" You know, my friends, you know, we're joking today, and I don't mean to discount the fact that we're living in troubling times right now. And I know it's on the heart of so many of us, the continued and the escalating violence that's happening right now in the Middle East between Iran and Israel. And I also am keenly aware, as all of you are, that there's so much anger and so much hate and so much pain. And in the midst of all of that, there is so much hunger in our country, in our world, in our very town of La Crosse right now. Just think of how many opportunities Jesus gives us to serve him, to give him something to eat. We do that when we serve people all around us who are hungry and thirsty. So we're in the third Sunday of Easter, and we're living on this side of the resurrection of our Lord, the Lord of all creation, Jesus Christ. For many, the good news that death is defeated, that Jesus brings forgiveness for the whole world, that Jesus is present with us now and forever, might be just too good to understand. Maybe even for us, it's too good for us to wrap our heads around. But my friends, never underestimate what God can do. Never underestimate the power of a good piece of broiled fish. Amen.
As
With the whole church, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. O God, our Holy One, you feed our deepest hungers. As we share the holy meal that is the body and blood of Jesus given for us, lead us to share all that we have and find in generosity abundant life. God of grace, hear our prayer. O God, our Creator, you bring forth all life on earth. Calm storms, bring water to parched places, and protect the climate, that is, that this planet would sustain life in all its variety. God of grace, hear our prayer. O God, our Savior, you offer wisdom and guidance beyond all human knowledge. Instruct lawmakers, judges, and elected officials to make decisions grounded in your justice and care for all your people. God of grace, hear our prayer. O God, our elder, you care for all your children. Encourage those who are in times of transition, facing the loss of old ways and routines and anticipating change. Guide those who journey in grief, hope, and uncertainty. God of grace, hear our prayer. O God, our center, you bring all people together in you. Help us to remember our identity and purpose in our ministry. Move us to love our neighbors as ourselves and to share in beloved community. God of grace, hear our prayer. O God, our resting place, your Son Jesus promised that we are held in your love forever. We remember our beloved who have died. And as we remember and share their love, comfort those who mourn. God of grace, hear our prayer. Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you. Please be seated. Well, you can also share a sign of God's peace with each other. It's like, why is everybody being quiet? This time we receive our morning offering, and in addition to the morning offering, we have our hungry jar. Let us pray. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen. Friends, we stand in body and spirit. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy,
he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Sometimes I have the best seat in the house to hear this amazing choir. You sound beautiful this morning, friends. We gather together to share this most holy meal. And we invite you to come forward. This gift of Jesus is for all of us. All are welcome to this table. If you would require gluten-free wafer, please let me know. Likewise, if you'd rather have grape juice instead of wine, we ask that you take the colored cup in the tray, and the service will know to provide you with grape juice. For those of you joining us online this morning, my friends, this is the body of Christ given for you. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. The risen Christ is made known to us in the breaking of the bread. Come and eat at God's table.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend.
Amen.
A few announcements I'd like to share with you. You might have noticed that I was going solo today. Pastor Becky is finishing up a vacation, so she'll be back in the office tomorrow, and so we pray for Pastor Becky in this time away for her. Next Sunday, we will be having a special meeting of the Congregation of English Lutheran Church at noon, at 12 noon. The purpose of this meeting will be to consider accepting a purchase agreement for our house that we have for sale. It's been on the market, it's been shown this week. We planned a meeting because odds are pretty darn good that we're going to have some offers to consider this next meeting. So a special congregational meeting next Sunday at noon, and we ask that you please be there. Pastor Becky and Cheryl will be offering a guided bird hike at Goose Island County Park on Saturday, April 27th, beginning at 9 a.m. Pastor Becky asks that you meet at the Shady Maple Interpretive Trail within the park. Bring your binoculars and be prepared for wet, muddy trails. And you can contact the office or Pastor Becky for more information. The ninth grade confirmation class will be affirming their baptisms at a special confirmation worship on Sunday, April 28th at our 10:45 worship. So I ask that you please remember our ninth graders in your thoughts and prayers. We had another milestone today. This morning, we had Charlotte, who celebrated her first communion this morning. And Charlotte's standing up, and let's show our appreciation for Charlotte. What an awesome day. God's peace and blessing, Charlotte. And dear friends, I invite you to stand in body and spirit. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Have a seat. Jared, you're supposed to remind me that you had an announcement.
Sorry about that. If you are in 7th through 12th grade at 9:45 in the youth room, there will be games and treats if you would like to join us. Thanks.
Games and treats, 9:45, awesome. All right, I'm sorry. Now can you please stand? Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, in the spirit of Easter hope, bless you now and always. Amen. Amen. Our sending him, let us talents and tongues employ.
Yeah.
rejoice and be glad.
Thanks be to God.